Hi everyone, welcome to my channel. This is Quantum Unicorn. If this is your first time tuning into my program, I want to let you know that all the demos and data files in my program are free to download. You can find these files by clicking the link below the video. And if you are a returning viewer, I hope you have taken my advice and spent some time practicing the code we covered in our last episode. And just a kind reminder, this course is meant for educational purpose only. The data and information presented in this video is not investment advice, okay? And please subscribe to my channel, like the video, and click the bell icon on to receive the latest updates. Thank you. In the last video, which was the confidence and interval episode, our emphasis was on explaining these concepts in statistics and introducing their applications in the finance field. Considering that you now have a good understanding of the above content, today we will do a detailed breakdown of the Python code for each module. By gaining a deeper understanding of the application of Python code in these specific scenarios, you will be able to better grasp the topic we are learning and lay a solid foundation for future learning. How exciting! Well, let's get started. Here's the code. This code is calculating the 95% confidence interval for a simple mean using this formula, where x is the sample mean, S is the sample standard deviation, N is the sample size, Z is the Z-score for the desired confidence level, and CI stands for the confidence interval. Okay, and let's break down each line of code. Here we are defining the sample mean, sample standard deviation, and sample size using some arbitrary values. In practice, you would replace these values with the actual values from your own data. And here we are using the norm PPF function from the SciPy stats module to calculate the z-score for the desired confidence level. In this case, we want the 95% confidence level, which corresponds to a z-score of 1.96, approximately. The norm PPF function takes as input the desired probability and returns the z-score that corresponds to that probability. Then we print out the value of z for informational purpose. Lastly, we calculate the confidence interval using the formula we saw earlier. Then we calculate the lower bound of the confidence interval left, and the upper bound of the confidence interval right, and then print out the 95% confidence interval as a tuple. Next, this cell looks like it calculates the confidence interval for a given data set with a specified confidence level. First, we define an example data set with 5 values. And then these 2 lines calculate the sample mean and sample standard deviation for the example data set. MP mean calculates the mean or average of the data set, and MPSTD calculates the standard deviation. The DOF equals 1 parameter in MPSTD specifies that the sample standard deviation should be calculated instead of the population standard deviation. Then we need to determine the confidence level. This line specifies the confidence level as 0.08 or 80%. Pretty straightforward, right? Okay, moving on. This line uses norm PPF function to look up the z value for a given confidence level. Norm PPF is the percent point function of the standard normal distribution and returns the critical value for a given probability or percentile. The product of 1 plus confidence level over 2 calculates the probability in the tail of the distribution, which is used to look up the z value. Then we calculate the standard error, which is the standard deviation of the sample mean. It is calculated by dividing the sample standard deviation by the square root of the sample size. And these two lines calculate the confidence interval for the example data set. The lower bound is calculated by subtracting the product of the z value and the standard error from the sample mean. The upper bound is calculated by adding the product of the z value and the standard error to the sample mean. Lastly, these lines print the results. The z value and sample mean are printed to verify the inputs. The 80% confidence interval is printed with the lower and upper bounds, formatted as a string. The int confidence level multiply 100. This expression converts the confidence level from decimal to a percentage for printing. Moving on next, here, first, we use this line to generate a random sample of 100 values from a standard normal distribution using the NumPy random normal function from NumPy. And these two lines calculate the mean and standard deviation of the sample using the NPMean and NPSTD functions from NumPy. We set the degrees of freedom parameter to 1 since we are working with the sample, not the entire population. And then we set a specific value for which we want to calculate the z-score. In this case, it's 1.5. Then we calculate the z-score using this formula, where value is the specific value we set in the previous line, mean is the mean of the sample, and STD def is the standard deviation of the sample. Then we calculate the probability of the z-score being less than a certain value using the stats norm CDF function from the SciPy stats module. This function calculates the cumulative distribution function of the standard normal distribution. Okay, let's move on to the next cell. Here I'm going to skip a bunch of code that I believe we have discussed many, many times. I'm just going to go right to here. Values for calculating the 80% confidence interval. These two lines of code calculate the value of the 80% confidence interval. The norm PPF function from the SciPy stats module is used to calculate the z-score corresponding to the 10th and the 19th percentiles of the standard normal distribution. These z-scores are stored in variables called z-left and z-right, respectively. Then we calculate the sample size, which is simply the number of rows in the log return column of the data frame. Also, we need to calculate the sample mean of the log return column using the mean method of the data frame. And in this cell, the last line of the code calculates the sample standard deviation of the log return column using the STD method of the data frame with the DOF parameter set to 1. In this case, we are assuming that the sample is a random sample from a larger population. So we use the default value of DOF equals 1 to correct for the bias in the sample standard deviation. Finally, we divide the sample standard deviation by the square root of the sample size to get the standard error of the sample mean, which is stored in a variable called sampleSTD. Okay, finally, here comes our last cell. The interval left and the interval right, these two lines of code are calculating the confidence interval. The sample mean variable represents the mean of the daily returns, which has already been calculated earlier. The z value as the z left and z right variables are the left and right quantiles, respectively, which are determined by the confidence level specified. In this case, z left and z right are the 10th and the 90th percentiles, respectively, because the confidence level is 80%. And finally, sampleSTD is the standard deviation of the daily returns, and it is used to calculate the width of the confidence level interval. The lower and upper bounds of the confidence interval are obtained by multiplying the standard deviation by the quantiles and adding the mean. And these lines print out the 80% confidence interval for the daily return of the stock. The interval left variable is the lower bound of the interval, and the interval right is the upper bound. The parentheses around interval left, interval right, create a tuple, which is a type of data structure that holds multiple values together. The tuple is then printed along with the separator message. Overall, this code is a simple example of how to calculate a confidence interval for the daily return of a stock. The code uses the sample mean, sample standard deviation, and the left and right quantiles to determine the confidence interval. Congratulations, folks! That's all for today's tutorial. And remember, practice makes perfect. So keep working hard and experimenting with what you have learned. And if you still have any questions or feel that you have not fully understood, well, or if you need more explanations or examples from me, please express your needs in the comments section. I'm more than happy to help you out. And speaking of comments, I'm always open to your feedback and suggestions. So if you have got any thoughts on how we can make this program even better, please don't be shy about sharing them. And if you haven't already, I would love it if you could subscribe to my channel to stay updated on my latest videos. And if you have friends or family who would also appreciate the knowledge of building stock trading models in Python, please feel free to share my videos with them. I truly appreciate your support, and I am excited to continue sharing more tutorials with you on my channel. Thank you again for your time. I wish you well and look forward to catching you all in the next episode. Goodbye.